Freeman. You've played rugby league test match football here in Melbourne last year.
They're willing them on for an upset victory.
So Dennis Hale checks with both captains. And the second test in the KFC Battle of the Ashes is underway, and the roar of the crowd lets us know it is. And Australia bring it out. And one of the big men, it's Sirenin, who had a wonderful game at the Sydney Football Stadium, who brings it almost out to the quarter line. That's Walters, the dummy half. Australia take it out through Clyde. Plenty of Great Britain Guernseys up there to put him in the deck, including Skerritt. A couple of changes made to this Great Britain side. Perhaps the most surprising was that Crooks was left out after such a great game in the first test. But he certainly didn't do a great deal in attack, despite the fact that he did come up with 41 tackles. And Great Britain tonight, Gary Freeman, are desperate for points. They need to put points on the board.
They have to score early in the test match, but I'd say that the main thing watching straight away now is their defence is solid as a rock. Australia now have the kick out of trouble. And they're putting plenty of pressure on Australia straight away, so it's good to see the bad kick there from Ennis-Houser because of the pressure that they're putting on him.
And straight off the side of the boot, and Martin Afaia gets his first touch of the football. Back towards the halfway come Great Britain. And Steadman gets to within 12 metres of the halfway line. Interesting to note that Peter Jackson, who was under some doubt for this test match, came out and warmed up. A great tackle from the Australians there. Sirenin up there with Gillespie. But Jackson warmed up in joggers, which, considering that the ground's greasy, was rather surprising. You'd think he'd want to get a good chance to get a grip of this ground to find out whether he needed longer sprigs or not, Gary.
Yeah, I was quite amazed to see him come out with those sand shoes on, but he probably showed he was just a little bit relaxed, but we do know now that he has actually got boots on, so that's a big plus for the Australian side.
It certainly is. Steadman's kick straight down the throat of Ennis-Houser. Ennis-Houser bringing it back. Great tackle from Schofield. Leading by example, Wishart. A great win by the Great Britain side over Newcastle on Tuesday night has certainly built their confidence. Admittedly, this side wasn't the side that beat Newcastle, but it certainly gave them some confidence after an unhappy week and a half.
Well, they scored a great victory over Newcastle. It just showed that the enthusiasm of the camp is still there. And I'd say that they're proving that out there tonight too, Dave, is that enthusiasm defence, they're getting up very, very quickly, and the Australians really are struggling to get back. There's a couple of players just walking.
Jackson this time. The kick. Steadman waits for it. Steadman brings it back. These days plays with Castleford. Good defence from Australia. It wasn't at Castleford when you were over there.
No, he was at a club called York, and actually I played against him in a Wembley Cup final game and semi-final game, I should say, and he was one of the players that beat us on the day. Scored two tries and kicked about three goals.
And Great Britain bring it out. It was Andy Platt, one of the Wigan Six, the first time ever in rugby league history that the one team here is represented by one club in the forward pack. In fact, the Wigan Six out there, helped, of course, by the halfback. Also coming from Wigan, and Schofield's made a break. He's got Afaia on his outside. He sends it to Afaia. Oh, great tackle from behind. That was magnificent work from Wishart. He was away, and I thought that Schofield could have passed it on the inside. Perhaps that was the safer way to go. The chip over the top. Langer's back there. Langer loses it, but then finishes up it, forcing it dead, and play will restart with a line dropout. Great work, Great Britain. Great work, Schofield. But perhaps they could have gone inside instead of Afaia, but Edwards almost made them pay anyway.
He sure did, David. I think the best thing that there, Ennis-Houser really held off Schofield, and that's what really put Schofield in two minds, whether to pass the ball inside or outside. He's looking at Afaia to get away, but Rod Wishart made up extremely good ground to cut him down.
And on the KFC replay, you saw that Wishart was never allowing Afaia to get away from him, but there were two players on the inside of Schofield, and he could easily have gone on the inside and may well have seen a Great Britain try result. Steadman knocks it down with the chest. It isn't a knock-on. Just inside Australia's territory. And that's the man who's playing his first test match, Billy McGinty. Skerritt takes it up, penalty against Australia inside the five. Well, this is a good chance for them. This is not a difficult position to have a shot at goal. Is Eastwood coming across to have the kick? And Schofield grabs hold of the football. What's he going to do? He's the skipper. Now here's the replay on the KFC replay. The Australians, a number of them out wide, including Jackson, caught offside by referee Dennis Hale. And Paul Eastwood, the man who was a hero and a villain in successive tests just 2 years ago. Eastwood, from a position not dissimilar to this, had a chance to win the Ashes series. When at Old Trafford, he could have converted a Lachlan try. He could have made it 12-10. And Paul Eastwood, who had a memorable game in that first Test match just a couple of years ago. And this young man who plays in Hull, with Hull Kingston Rovers, just 26. The chance to post the first points on the board. But at Wembley 2 years ago, he scored a try and kicked Great Britain to victory. And just the following Test had a chance from almost a position identical to this to kick them to victory. It missed, and Inga scored a try in the final moments of the game, and Australia lived to fight another day. Is that going through Eastwood's mind at the moment?
Well, for Eastwood's sake, I hope not, and for Mal Reilly's sake too. I think he'd be just interested in getting the ball straight out between the sticks today, Dave.
Here he is. We've got a great view of it. It's there. It's as straight as a die, and Great Britain take the lead. On the KFC scoreboard, it's Great Britain leading Australia by 2-0. Paul Eastwood has kicked the first points of the Test match, and Great Britain lead 2-0, and that will do his confidence the world of good. He was a shattered man after missing that goal. It took him a long time to recover. Is it going to be at Prince's Park in Melbourne, Victoria, where Paul Eastwood regains his spurs? That was Powell bringing it up strongly. He's playing in Guernsey 3, and Newlove, his partner, is playing in number 4.
Tell you what's happening with the Australian back line is that Jackson's making a number of tackles around the ruck area and leaving Langer and Meninga out short on the left-hand side, Dave.
So Great Britain just outside their own quarter line, and here's McGinty. Australian player down hurt. That's Harrigan, who's not too well at the moment, and Dermott gives him a little bit of lip as he was trying to get to his feet too, and that's a good kick. Hancock. And so not much in the possession battle so far. Great Britain have had a little bit more of the ball in the early part of the game, and they're leading by 2-0. And I would have thought, Gary, what they've done so far, they've done exceedingly well. They've been playing, certainly feeling a bit more confident than they were perhaps at the end of that match in Sydney.
Yeah, they are playing very, very confident, and they're having a great defensive line too at the same time. They're sliding, picking out their players, but their actual play with the ball has been good, with their general kicking play, putting Australia under a lot of pressure.
Now this is Langer who's forced to put the kick in this time. Is it going to go dead? It isn't. Stedman's not even going to think about letting it try and go dead. He picks it up and brings it back, and a good run from the fullback. Brings it out to the quarter line. That was good football.
That was good stepping. He stepped on off his right, off his left. Oh, he's lucky he didn't have a knock on there on Gary Schofield. Bad play the ball by Stedman after that great little bit of work.
Proud to have a go at the New Zealand referee, but he was well positioned.
Good decision by the ref. I'll stick with Dennis.
So Wigan, the forward pack. Betts, this is. That must help their combination too. Dermott goes the dummy and goes straight down the centre, but nobody earned the inside and penalty against Australia. There was a bit of holding back there. One of the Great Britain players coming through on the inside. Here's Dermott on the KFC replay, looking around, and the player had been held back. I think Harrigan was the offender, and the referee very quick to spot it. Not a great kick, but they've got 6 to go. Skerritt. Andy Platt. Another penalty against Australia up inside the 5. Well, they can't say there's anything wrong with Dennis Hale. He pointed out the 3 of them before he played the ball. He actually pointed to 3 Australians and told them to get into position.
Yeah, he did do that, and he sort of went and said to him, actually he was running through, let the player go, let the player go, and he wasn't going to penalise, but he did the right thing by penalising him, just because this was another shot at goal day. A great scoring opportunity this early into the game.
Well, this rain has not stopped. It's not heavy, it's not really light, it's just constant. You don't see it on the screen, it's such a beautiful picture. But I suppose a couple of early penalty goals, if it gets heavy, well, anything can happen once the rain starts to get heavy, because a couple of goals may be just enough advantage to sneak away with the game, especially in Melbourne where the ground's already a little bit damp and soft underfoot. They don't get much sunshine in the winter time, so once the ground does get, so perhaps, well, it's the South Island of New Zealand, it'll be much the same, would have thought, Gary, that once the grounds get very heavy in the winter time, it's very hard. They don't get enough sunshine to dry out. And so only a little bit of rain, and again, the grounds become a little bit heavy, which one would think would certainly give the Great Britain side some sort of advantage, especially if they can get a four-point lead early in the game, which is possible.
Yeah, I think the four-point lead's going to be very, very handy for the Great Britain side. I think they look more enthusiastic, too, about trying to win this test match. I think the Australians think they should come down here and they would have just won the game easily by that scoreline in the first test. But I think if Gary Schofield and Stedman can get into a good kicking game, when they do get 4 points up, they'll put a lot of pressure on Australia right throughout the whole game.
There's the kick from Eastwood. It looks beautiful off the boot. Magnificent stuff. Martin Week raises the flag. And on the KFC scoreboard, Great Britain have skipped away to an early lead here in the second test match in Melbourne. Paul Eastwood 2 from 2. Great Britain lead Australia 4-0. And he brought his kicking boots with him today.
He sure did. And he let everyone know about his kick too when he put the big right arm up there to say, there you go, see that.
Brings it back strongly for the Great Britain side. Well, what's it like playing? You've played for New Zealand when you've got an early lead against Australia. What sort of confidence does that give you?
Oh, it's a big boost in confidence, and you can see the Great Britain side now. They're really looking to try and spread the ball early, take it up strongly, and put Australia under a lot of pressure. They're working right to this side. See, Jackson's still caught on that right-hand side of the field. He's not getting out to help Meninga at all.
Great Britain just outside the quarter line. Gee, the referee almost pinged Australia again then as Dermot goes for a run. Good run from Dermot. Away to Betts. Betts up towards the halfway line. Dermot again causing just a couple of problems. Here's Stedman being chased by Langer. Langer can't catch him. And Stedman, a good kick. He's made Ettinghausen run a long way towards the touchline. So Great Britain, as you can see, a slight advantage here as well. 3-0. And Australia knock it on. So more mistakes on Australia. And Betts picks up the crumbs. And Betts still going. Well, he made a statement during the week, Dennis Betts, that he'd been stale on tour. But surely, sooner or later, he's trying hard. But surely, he said, something's got to motivate him. He said, it's not as if he's not trying, but something's not working. Well, tonight so far, we've seen him start to put a few of those skills together. It made a few people say less than 12 months ago he might be the best second rower in the world. Great Britain make a mistake. Might see a bit of that tonight with his ball starting to get a bit greasy. Australia working it back towards the halfway line. This is Jackson. He's been under a huge injury cloud and that wouldn't have helped. Great tackle, Billy McGinney. Look at this on the KFC replay. Come here, bang, just stop him in his tracks.
It was a great tackle. It set the defence is winning tonight's game so far by Great Britain, but Australia, their forwards don't really look interested in running the ball at all.
Well, there hasn't been those big, strong hit-ups we saw in the first match from, say, Harrig and then Surinam and Linden. We haven't seen a great deal of in attack in the early stages of this game.
Well, we haven't seen them in attack, and we haven't really seen them in defence pulling off the big tackles either. The only guy that we're really having a big game so far is probably is Bradley Coyne.
There he is again with the super tackle. That wasn't a knock-on. It came off his boot. Some of the crowd thought it was. Black brings it up strongly. Dermot having a busy game in the early part of the game. This is Newlove. Schofield seemed to be hit very late after delivering that pass. Now, a flag decides to go on his own from dummy half. Pickard, the touch judge on this side of the field, looked towards the referee, but I think the referee was quite content that Schofield and perhaps Jackson came together at the same time. Ettinghausen doesn't take that well. And if there's one flaw in Andrew Ettinghausen's game so far this year, it's been that he hasn't been taking the ball on the full with confidence. We saw one in the first test match, Gary, where he allowed it to bounce. They didn't give him any more high ones to take. No, during this season of football, I don't think he's been playing with a great deal of confidence.
No, well, his team hasn't been going that well either, so you've got to build your confidence on how well your team goes. But here's a great little run here by Hancock. Tremendous left-hand fin there to help Australia out. But I think Great Britain tonight really got to put the ball up the in-house and make it work, Dave.
So Great Britain on the KFC scoreboard, leading by 4-0. Langer, haven't seen him have to do much yet. He hasn't really been given any opportunities. This is a good-looking kick, but it's going to go a little bit too long, a little bit too wide. Crosses the touch in goal line, and play will restart from the centre of the quarter line. That will give the Great Britain side just that little bit of breathing space. The precision not yet there in the Australian kicking game either.
No, they really are rushing a lot of things, and Bobby Linder slowly getting back into the line of defence. Took a little bit of a knock to the head there. So they'll be trying to push the ball out to where Bobby is and try and run it to make him do a little bit more tackling.
Dermott, this is McGinty, runs straight and hard at Jackson. Searing him there as well. Betts. Won't get through there, Meninga and Langer. It wouldn't have been a much harder combination to try and break than anywhere in world football than those two. And in the back play, Dermott's into it, and so too is Harrigan. And Dermott's a very fiery customer. He and Harrigan, they just ran into each other, and Dermott and Harrigan, I think Harrigan might have let the first one go too, I might add, but Dermott's been never one not to retaliate. Dermott was in there, and so Platt's come in and lent a few more. But I had the feeling that Harrigan might have thrown the first one then.
It all started really when the hooker went to go through as a backer up, and Harrigan's grabbed him, he's let one fly straight away.
It'll be interesting to see. Harrigan's been called out, but I had the feeling that Harrigan threw the first one, and Dermott said, I'm not going to cop any of that.
Well, it really depends on how the Australian touch judges interpret this, David, doesn't it?
Well, I get the feeling the penalty's going to go Great Britain's way.
Yes.
It is. Good interpretation. Here it is again. See, now there it is. Well, I'm not sure when you have a look at that. The first part of it was only a push-off, but look at Dermott. There's a couple of good ones going in on the KFC replay, but I can assure you this little hooker from Wigan, when he played with Hull a few years ago, his head's so tough that Noel Cleal ended his international career by breaking his arm on his head.
Well, in the KFC replay there, you see that the referee get involved in there, trying to stop the fight, and he was really ducking his head to get away from the blaze from Harrigan and McDermott.
Well, yet another error then, but gee, they're putting some pressure on. The Skerritt tried to tow that ball through. It almost came up with possession, but instead Great Britain have been able to win the scrum, and Schofield almost got in behind the defence. Great Britain putting plenty of pressure on here. Powell, away it comes. Clark throws the dummy, he's gone straight through, and Clark will score a magnificent try. Gee, he's the fella they said they shouldn't have brought out. He was just about, besides Crooks, the best forward they had on the field in the first match. He's come up with a super try. Great try from Phil Clark. He's had to fill huge boots on this tour. He's had to come into the lock forward position. He's had to take Ellery Hanley's spot, and Hanley would have been more than proud to have scored that. Have a look at this. It comes out to Clark, the big dummy, inside Sirenen, easily away from Harrigan, and goes over the four-pointer. Great try. Good football here from Clark.
Great football here, and he really sizes up, throws the big dummy, steps on the right, steps inside zero, and just the amount of power that the young bloke's got away from Harrigan, scores a sensational try, and now it's really going to look Great Britain's confidence. I tell you what, for Australia, don't think that's what's going to happen to them like did last year. They might come away with a loss tonight.
Well, the way this match is going so far, they'll never play another test, actually.
No, that's what I was going to say too, Dave.
Okay, Paul Clark. There's Phil Clark, I should say, this very, very capable young man from Wigan. There was a lot of eyebrows raised when the 21-year-old was chosen in the side. This is his fourth test match, but he'd only played about 9 or 10 first-grade games in Wigan colours. But Morris Lindsay and Mal Reilly had plenty of confidence that this young man could do the job, and so far he stood the test and stood it well. He played very well in Sydney, and he's come up with a vital try here. And Eastwood has a handy position here to post the extras and send this Great Britain side away on the KFC scoreboard to a 10-0 lead. He struck the first two kicks beautifully. They're catching Australia tonight, aren't they? Getting in behind the defence easily so far. Halfway through the first half, here's Eastwood. Strucks it beautifully. Two more points to Great Britain. Eastwood's kick three from three. And on the KFC scoreboard, it's Great Britain 10, leading Australia 0. Gary Freeman suggests that all New Zealand-Australia test matches should be played in Melbourne from now on.
Yeah, and I think the Great Britain side will be thinking the same along the same lines too, Dave.
But, long way to go in this game yet, yeah. But gee, hasn't it been a great start to them? Everyone wrote them off.
Well, that's what they did with New Zealand last year, and Great Britain are really turning things around, and their confidence is going to be sky high.
Powell brings it back strongly. Australia have got the ball, in the play the ball. It's one area they just can't relax. This is a time when Australia really have to apply the pressure. And now Australia have lost the ball. Harrigan and Surinam have had disappointing starts to this match so far compared to the way that they so magnificently dominated the first match. Betts, this fellow's playing a lot better, isn't he?
Oh, he's having a great game tonight. I think he's a little bit quiet in the first test, but he's getting a little bit more wider, running a bit more freely, and the Australian defence is as tough as it was in the first test match.
I reckon Dean Lonigan sitting back there in the studio might be having some happy memories of when New Zealand put Australia away so brilliantly last year.
Yeah, I think Dino will be having happy memories. There's a bad knock on there by Gary Schofield, and Lange's just clean up for Australia. This is what Great Britain can't do. Put themselves under pressure, their own 25. They've got to get out there as soon as they can.
Walters, Harrigan. Harrigan, good strong run, but good defence. That was McGinty Lowe. Sirinen on the fringe of the ruck. No way through there at the moment. This is good Great Britain defence. They're moving up and not allowing the big Australian men to get much momentum. Wide ball. Langer hasn't had much opportunity to do much yet. Out wide it comes. Here's Daly. Daly, the dangerous man. That looked to be a forward pass to Wishart. But look at the Great Britain defence. And they push him across the touchline. And the scrum will go down.
They did slide very, very well in Great Britain, you know, to cover up both Meninga and Wishart there. I thought it was great. And here's Daly going across the field now. It just drops the ball inside, but good defence there by Schofield and Newler to drag him over the side and get the feed for the Great Britain side, their own 25.
I'll tell you something, Schofield was involved in the tackle on the previous tackle on the far side of the field. He's having a great captain's knock so far.
Yeah, he's playing extremely well and really directing his traffic all around the paddock well too.
Newler. And that from Featherston, who can show them a clean pair of heels, have given a chance too. Apparently he's got plenty of speed. We haven't had many chances to see it on tour so far. That's Powell, his centre teammate. The game, ground made up the centre of the Australian ruck. Dermott's made some good ground so far. This is McGinty. Last tackle. Steadman. Well, there hasn't been too many errors in this match so far. A couple of handling errors, and considering the greasy ball, that's a testament to just how well these players out there are playing the game tonight. Well, Gary, that's the area where Great Britain had to pick up. They missed more than 40 tackles in the first test. Tonight, they've only missed 3, and Australia have already missed 5, reflected on the scoreboard with a Great Britain leading 10-0.
Yeah, on the scoreboard's the 10 points, and that's is reflected by the guys missing the tackles first up, and it's something Australia's really got to rectify straight away. Will Bobby Fulton be saying something at half-time to the boys?
Great Britain and Australia just outside the quarter line, as you can see. Great Britain have had more of the football so far, but what they've had of it, they've used well, because they lead by 10 points to nil. We haven't really seen Australia make a clean break in this game yet. It's going to take a little bit of Langer magic, one feels.
It's going to take a bit of magic from the whole Australian side. They've really got to start working in together. They're going to go wide here with Jackson and Meninga.
Linder goes without it, knocks it on, and Eastwood cleans it up for Great Britain.
I wonder if he couldn't catch that. It was thrown to him like a bullet from Jackson.
It wasn't an easy one, was it? And Daly tries to take Steadman wide. Powell, wrong foot's Daly. And that's very rarely you see anyone do that. But again, this greasy field isn't going to help them trying to step. Great Britain playing good straight-up football at the moment.
Well, they really are picking their times, Dave, when to move the football, when not to move it. And he goes Sean Edwards with a short break.
Eastwood. Steadman again, under pressure from Hancock. He's got his kick in, bounces once, crosses the touchline, and we're going to see the scrum go down. Some of the crowd on that side of the field thought that perhaps Hancock might have finished off the tackle. Here's the KFC replay. Oh, when you see it, I think that was totally fair enough, wasn't it?
Oh, a good decision by the referee just to put the scrum down. You know, it was just really a touch, but it was a good dive. Could be an Oscar.
When you have a look at the replay, there wasn't much in that. He Now, Australia, this is Daly. There's one man that can turn the game round quickly. It's Laurie Daly. That'll be a penalty. Second tackle.
Then Daly went to 5'8", trying to be explosive straight away as soon as he gets the ball off Langer. Moving Jackson to the centre spot.
Well, I don't think there's much. Oh, great tackle from Great Britain. That really was. Platt was involved in that very heavily, and Hancock will wake up with a couple of sore ribs tomorrow morning after that one. Well, Platt's another player that we've all very highly rated over the years. And today, along with Betts, they're really starting to show some of their wares in the early part of this game. 30 minutes gone in the Test match. Great Britain on the KFC scoreboard, leading Australia 10-0. Langer, wide it comes to Jackson. And Jackson's halfway through a hole back to Langer. He's knocked it on. And Great Britain come up with possession through Andy Platt. Well, that was Australia's first opportunity. The first time they've created anything in the Test match so far. It's taken them half an hour.
Yeah, around that ruck area, they are a little bit vulnerable, Great Britain. They are spreading a little bit wide because they're thinking Australia's going to spread the ball out wide. It's just leaving that area a bit short, but Jackson picked out the hole beautifully.
Oh. At the moment, the Great Britain side don't mind if Harrigan lies all over them at all. With only 10 minutes to go at half-time, this is the time when Great Britain would love to slow it down so they don't let Australia into the Test match.
Oh, that's a penalty there.
That's against McGinty.
Kicking in the tackle, it was, Dave.
There wasn't much doubt about it. Well, that's the sort of silly mistakes. Here he is, comes up, Billy McGinty. Daly's there all over him. There he is, clear as a bell. So Billy McGinty will rue that, playing his first Test match. And this is Australia's opportunity. Australia are always at their hardest to stop 10 minutes before the break. Wishart. Great Britain have got a weakness, it's their lack of fitness. Again, great Britain defence. Harrigan down the centre, Betts underneath. Sirenin. Bad bit of football, Langer's gone without it. Great Britain have got it, now Australia have got it. The referee will put a scrum down. It'll be for the knock-on, so Great Britain get the chance to feed the scrum.
I think Great Britain are thinking themselves very, very lucky there, Ciro. Just turning the ball inside. Bit of a bad pass low for Langer. Just a knock on there.
Well, when you had a look at it, the ball seemed to go behind Langer and hit his legs. But it's difficult for the referee. When we first saw it, we thought the ball had gone forward. He only gets one look at it too.
Yeah. He doesn't have the KFC replay, does he?
No. Just outside the quarter line, Great Britain. They've really started this Test match in fine fettle. Eastwood's kicked 3 from 3. Clark has scored a try, and if you've just got home in New Zealand, would you believe it? Yes, it's true. Great Britain are leading by 10 points to nil. And have played by far the better football. No fluke in that score. The kick, Eddinghausen takes it safely. Runs to the short side. And as you can see, Australia making some uncustomary errors. Langer's made a couple, although the passes that he did knock on weren't good. But Great Britain holding onto the ball and not missing their tackles tonight. And Australia losing the ball. These aren't errors that they normally make. This Australian side has been flustered by some very committed Great Britain football tonight. And there it is, Schofield. According to the referee, quite at liberty to do that. Played at the ball was on the ground, and he got round the man playing the ball, and Walters looked at the referee instead of falling on the football.
Didn't play to the whistle there, David.
Gee, this fellow's played strongly tonight, I think, Dermott, and a good pass finds Edwards! Edwards decides to championship ahead. Here comes the fire. Will the fire win the race? Oh, he's missed it. The Great Britain has still scored. It's New Love has scored the try. I think he'll get it. Let's see who the referee had finally awarded it to. I thought it was New Love who actually landed on the football. Martin, the fire went straight over the top of it. McGinty came through. It was a great chip. But I get the feeling that it was Paul Newlove who fell on the ball. Again, the break from Dermot. Here's Sean Edwards, the will of the wisp. Away he goes. The chip kick on the KMC replay. He's kicking for a fire's wing. Now look at the speed of a fire. They all miss it, and I reckon Newlove's got there first. Newlove and McGinty will claim it between them, but I reckon the centre's got there, Gary.
Yeah.
Look at this play. Dermot started that, and look at this footballer, Edwards.
Edwards makes a great break there. Goes to any house and chips over. It's a great place chip because O'Fire is the fastest winger in the game, and he goes round, he gets pitched, he's taken out of the play, but plenty of great attackers here to take the try. McGinty and Newlove.
Look at it here. Who do you think scores the try? I reckon Newlove was the one who scores it. And for mine, he firmly placed two hands on the football and comes up with a try. He'd be pretty happy with that. Why wouldn't he be? Because Great Britain are leading 14-0, and the way they're playing and the way Australia are playing, we're going to Lang Park next Friday night, and this KFC Battle of the Ashes is going to go right down to the wire. They're shell-shocked, that group. The Kangaroos are shell-shocked. They are tonight being shown a football lesson. Newlove there, scoring the try. But they have continually made breaks tonight, Great Britain. And that little hooker, you were surprised when he got a run, but hasn't he? Had the way of a game. Dermot, he's finding plenty of holes in this Australian lineup.
He is too. And I thought Lee Jackson, after the game against Newcastle, would get the starting lineup there. But Dermot really playing with his other five forwards, all from Wigan, are playing a sensational game around the ruck area and putting Australia under pressure. They're really making them work for the yards. And when they come out in defence, McDermott's leading them in a hurry.
It's going to be a hard night for us tonight. We're staying at the Hilton Hotel here in Melbourne. There's about 20 Australians, including the team, and about 6,000 Pommies.
It might be hard for you, Blakes, but I'm all right up in New Zealand. They don't come to New Zealand for another 2 weeks.
So Eastwood, he's kicked 3 from 3. Can he make it 4 from 4 and make it 16-0? Right on half-time. Eastwood moves in. It's there, is it? Yes! 2 more points to Great Britain. Not long to go before half-time, and the KFC scoreboard shows you that Great Britain are leading by 16-0.
What a happy crowd here, Dave. 8,000 screaming Great Britain fans, and very quiet for the Australian people. Why wouldn't it be? It's 16-0.
Well, Australia will have to play great football to get back from here, because Great Britain are playing well and Australia aren't at the moment. It's as simple as that. Well, they're not being allowed to. Great Britain are playing a disciplined game of football. Lang Park might be a different story. That's a bit hard up there playing in front of the Lang Park crowd, as you know.
Doesn't
matter whether you play for Balmain, East New Zealand, New South Wales. Once those banana benders get on your back, it's a bit hard. But Great Britain at the moment, they're doing it magnificently here at Princes Park. As Dermot, who's had a great first half, tackled by Meninga, back towards the halfway line. Last tackle against Great Britain. Steadman didn't get a good pass, but plenty of time still to get his kick in off the side of the boot. And still, it's going to be allowed to bounce between Wishart and Eddinghausen. A little bit of indecision in the Australian camp, as Wishart brings it back and he's crashed into the ground. More good defence. Is that Skerritt?
Skerritt was
the prop four. Eddinghausen goes without it and he lost that ball on the ground. Is it a knock-on? I thought it was. The referee says yes. He dead set did, didn't he, Gary? I thought he did.
A great decision there by Dennis Howe. He's under a bit of a pressure over here, but a great tackle here by Gary Schofield. And he has his back turned. Schofield comes and hits him. He tries to get up quickly, drops the ball. Great tackle, Gary Schofield.
KFC replay just showing how good a tackle it was and how good a decision from the referee it was. Here's Clark. Can they make it 20-0 before halftime? The way they're playing at the moment, this Great Britain side can really put Australia away here before the break. Skerritt's got within a couple of metres. Dermot, Platt, Edwards, Schofield, a little kick into the end goal area. Eddinghausen's gone without it. It's another Great Britain try. They're in again. Schofield has scored the try. The skipper. It's another try. It's 20-0 with the kick that come from in front. calm down. Here it is, the reverse. Edwards, Schofield, his former Balmain teammate, trying to get in the road, going without it, Ettinghausen, and Schofield says thank you underneath the post.
Yeah, the KFC replay shows Ettinghausen slipping on him. I said those sports brings it, and Gary Schofield does over a great try of the referee position. They do the switch play here to Edwards. Schofield, he sees a little gap there, he tips over, follows his kick through. He thought Ettinghausen had cleaned it up, but dives over to make a great try, make it 20-0. This will make it 22 when Eastwood puts this over.
So Gary Schofield, a magnificent player. He's been playing for Great Britain since back in 1984 when he came out here as a very young man. He's played 35 tests, including this one tonight. And the way things are going, there'll be no finer hour for him, because he's captain of his country tonight. And the way they're going, look at the elation in this Great Britain camp. They know that tonight looks like being their night, and we haven't even made it to the break. What a night for that man. You played with him at Balmain. He's a super bloke. And I tell you what, as an Aussie, if I'm ever going to get beaten by Great Britain, I wouldn't be... I'd love to see that fella be the captain, because he's a good bloke, isn't he?
Yeah, he is a good bloke, and I'd love to see him beat Australia too. But I think when... The Australian board gets together again. I don't think we'll see any more test matches down here in Melbourne, whether it be Olympic Park or Princes Park. I think they're going to go back to...
It's a great atmosphere tonight.
Oh,
it's sensational.
It is sensational.
The rain stopped now. Maybe that's to give Australia a chance in the second half.
Well, there's still 40 minutes to go in this game of football, and anything could happen. I've had a lot of ball, Great Britain.
So, Paul Eastwood. What a comeback to the Great Britain side. With the chance from in front, moves in, strikes it sweetly. And on the KFC scoreboard, it's Great Britain 22, leading Australia 0. Schofield reflecting on the fact that it's got to be mistake-free for the next couple of minutes before the break. And then go in at half-time and come out and virtually restart the game. Don't think that you've got the test match won. Is that the advice?
Yeah, the advice is there's still 40 minutes to go. We're actually probably around about 44 minutes. And they've got to just take the ball up for five tackles now, get a good kicking game employed, and don't let Australia have the ball in their 25, because that'll put them under pressure. They've just got to get out of their own 25 now.
Some test match of Australia get back into this game as Platt takes it out to the quarter line. It's been some test match already. They've played brilliantly. He almost slipped that ball, Skerritt, dig away to Newlove, who scored the second try. Dermott. This is Clark, who scored the first try. Midway, half and quarter line, inside Great Britain's territory. The big thing is I'm wondering whether Mal really's done it deliberately or it's just happened that way, but Great Britain's hardly played to a fire's wing. Has he done it deliberately to try and think that the Australian team might be stacking the defence on that side of the field, trying to catch them a bit short around the ruck and on the right side of the field? It's been noticeable tonight, no long passes to a fire side of the field.
Now they've really taken them up the middle. You know, right in the forward pack there. Now, if you want to win this game, it's got to be one up front. You know, you got demoralised last time when we played them. You know, you got to stand up and be counted. And I think that's what Malcolm's done, is say, play at the middle and fire in that. He'll get his chance later on in the game.
Here's Australia right on half-time. They need to score a try before the break if they've got any chance of getting back into this game. 22-0 on the KFC scoreboard. Great Britain have played magnificently as Jackson brings it up. A few metres Great Britain side of halfway. As now they bring it down towards the quarter line, Australia, on the last tackle. Gillespie finds Langer, who hoists it high. Coming through, there's a host of them. Steadman takes it brilliantly, despite the swinging arm of Jackson. Magnificent take from Steadman as the fire brings it out. Jackson came flying. Look at the swinging arm. Wasn't really as bad as it looked initially, I must admit. But Steadman did well, didn't he? He was under a lot of pressure.
Great take, because the Great Britain side were under immense pressure there. They had a heap of Australians coming through, and the Meninga and Jackson, and it was just a great take that relieved Great Britain of the pressure with only a couple of more minutes to go in this half.
Platt takes it out. The referee says that's the last tackle. There'll be a kick here. And Steadman again. He's played his role magnificently in this first half. I think only once has Ettinghausen been able to take the ball on the full. That time taking it with a lot more... Here he goes, Ettinghausen. Ettinghausen down that left flank. Schofield's across. The centre kick. Is the ball going to beat them all? Oh, Great Britain have fallen on it. Finally, Edwards shoves it over the dead ball line. But oh, how close that could have been for a Hancock try. That was just what happened at the other end when Ettinghausen missed it and Schofield scored. This time, as Ettinghausen makes the break down the left side of the field on the KFC replay, he sees on the inside that Hancock's gone towards that side of the field. He puts the little kick in. The kick bounces badly. It bounces awkwardly for everyone. Hancock can't get there. Nork and Powell. Edwards has a double go on it and finally knocks it over the dead ball line. Here's Ettinghausen bringing it back again. Anxious moments then for Great Britain. Hancock.
The Great Britain side are really getting off their line of defence. They're really coming straight up at Australia and putting pressure on them straight away.
Now here's Meninga. Meninga will be put across the touchline. He tried to use too much brute force and just ran out of football field. Surely there's no time left in this first half. Meninga, there he is. New Love, who's had a good first half, is there. Hancock on that far side of the field. Sorry to limp a little bit too. I hope he's okay for Australia's sake. As Great Britain come up with the football and Langer puts Stedman under pressure, and so too does Lindner. They've got to do it all the time. The fire gets out from dummy half. And again, that little man, Langer, clings to him like a limpet mine. Clark. Langer again. How many tackles can the little man do?
Well, he's trying to get them up, fired up, you know, but it's a little bit late, but there's only probably, hopefully, only 30 or 40 seconds to go in this half. But Langer's really trying to rally his team.
Last tackle against Great Britain. Sean Edwards decides to take the option at the line dropout.
That's a great play. Great play.
That's not so silly, is it? Because they're going to have to kick it from virtue of that position anyway. This time he gives his players a couple of seconds breather. And it might be one or two less tackles Australia have to bring the ball back.
Yeah, well, it really depends on now who's running the clock here. I'd like to know.
Well, maybe they think it's like Aussie rules. They just have time on.
Yeah, just go for 80.
There goes the siren. It's pretty loud. The referee, a loud shrill of the whistle, and at half-time, magnificent effort from Great Britain on the KFC scoreboard. Great Britain, from a standing ovation from their fans, go in leading 22 points to nil.
20 minutes. Let's go back to our other commentator, Dave Morrow.
Welcome back as the Great Britain side make their way back onto the football field here at Prince's Park. Why wouldn't they be smiling and waving? Might be half-time, but they're leading 22-0, and look at their 8,000 throng support. They'd be smiling all the way back home tonight. Plenty of support here. Look round some of these magnificent banners as Gary Schofield leads them back. There's one there called the Castleford Horse and Jockey. Gary Freeman's had a couple in there.
Yeah, I certainly have had a couple of there. And another little place in Cass called the Shipmate. Great
yes.
Little spot.
I've been there. And in the first half, well, Australia have had to do all the defensive effort. Siren and Harrigan and Walters doing most of that tackling for Australia, but Great Britain, who've really made inroads into the Australian attack tonight with some great tackling, and Skerritt and Platt, the front rowers, and Betts also lending assistance. The top tacklers for Great Britain as Meninga kicks off. A couple of Australian changes in this second half. We've seen Johns come onto the field and also Kevin Walters. And looking through across that side, it looks as if Daly and Jackson are the two that are off. I'm just trying to see.
Daly's at full.
Daly's at fullback. Aha, it's Wishart who's off. Ettinghausen's gone to the wing. Jackson's off. Now it looks as if Johns and Walters are playing in the centres. Daly, trying to find Daly on the football field. He's at fullback. Ettinghausen's gone to the wing. Wishart and Jackson are the two who are off the field. So Australia have had to make two changes at half-time. Well, Kevin Walters might be just what they require, Gary, because it's that type of footballer who is quite capable in attack of doing anything.
Yeah, I think that both players that they have put on in Johns and in Walters are that are very good defensive players too, and they have been missing out wide and occasionally, and that's why Daly's gone to fullback and Ettinghausen on the wing where they can be a bit more explosive.
What an incredible man this Daly is. Fulton decides to take him out of the line and make him fullback. And This is Schofield. Johns is in there at Guernsey 18. Did the ball get lost? The way Linda was reacting, I think he thought the ball was lost for a second. Great Britain, just inside Australia's territory. Dermot at dummy half. Sean Edwards decides to hoist it high. Now Eddinghausen, who's been at fullback, playing on the wing, has to take it anyway as if he was at fullback, takes it safely in front of a fire who came through very quickly. Linda brings it out to the quarter line. Interesting talking to a couple of the Great Britain supporters at halftime. Mike Stevenson, a former Great Britain hooker, said for the first time on tour, and he's been watching every part of the Great Britain tour, Dermot's been running with the football. And being a hooker, he said it's about time he did it. He said what a difference it's made to the Great Britain attack tonight.
Yeah, he's really sparked their attack around that ruck area. But you can see what Australia's going to do here, Dave, is that they're going to really use the ball wide. They've got their play right out to Walters early in the piece. They know that they're a few points behind, and they're going to spin the ball early if they can.
So the kick from Daly. Steadman deciding he'll return it. The spiral punt. Daly knocks it backwards. He's under a bit of pressure behind his own quarter line. The kick, a wobbly old one. A Great Britain knock it backwards, but they've got the ball. Dermot away now to Steadman. And Steadman decides to run it into the Australian forwards. Langer there as well. And on the KFC scoreboard, no change to the halftime score. It's Great Britain 22, leading Australia nil. They scored three tries in the first half. Phil Clark, Paul Newlove and Gary Schofield. And Paul Eastwood has a perfect kicking record, 5 from 5. Dermot, Betts, away from Johns. Johns comes again. Just inside Australia's territory. Edwards finds Schofield, and Schofield decides to hoist it high. Daly coming across takes it beautifully. He took that with confidence.
Yeah, just with so much ease, you know, he just came across and then the ball was coming out, just took it and made 15 or 16 metres here for the Australian side. You know, he's going to be really, really explosive from the back there, Dave.
Langer. Clyde. Haven't seen much of the Australians in attack tonight. Walters throws the dummy, goes on his own. He's got it away to Walters. Kevin Walters. Kevin Walters, can he get his pass away? He can't. He's only about 22 metres out. Meninga at dummy half. Sends it to Langer. Back it comes to Meninga. Meninga decides to float it over the top, but they've lost the ball. Oh, how easily that ball could have been scooped up and sent to a fire. Instead, the scrum will go down. Australia having to play catch-up football on the KFC replay. You see Linda going without it, but had Newlove been able to pick that up and get it away to a fire, that might have been curtains.
Well, it would have been curtains, and the only player really back there is Bradley Clyde, but he's down injured. I don't think he'd have any chance at all of catching on fire if he got it to the clear.
Cyril and Langer. The first sign of desperation from Australia all night. But Great Britain have got a good start. They lead by 22.
Australia's defence is more positive now around that ruck area. There's a mistake by five, knocks on, and that's what Australia wanted in this first 5 minutes of this game. Put pressure on the Great Britain side and try and get some early points, what they actually need.
Penalty against Great Britain. Gee, that could have easily been a knock-on against Linder. I thought from the back of that scrum, Linder almost knocked that on. Langer decides to take the tap. Here's the battering ram, Meninga. 11 metres out. Walters, Gillespie. Walters finds Harrigan charging down the centre, but again, good Great Britain defence stops him in his tracks. Only 9 metres away from the Great Britain line. Walters, Langer switches the point of the attack, but Langer can't find a passage through. Skerritt hit him. Kevin Walters. Back to his brother, Steve. Away it went to Johns. Penalty against Great Britain up inside the five.
This will be 18 tackles that Great Britain have really had to tackle for now.
Test of their spirit. Langer. Kevin Walters. Kevin Walters can't get behind the defence. 10 metres out still. That's Johns, the dummy half. Linder. Meninga. Away it goes to Eddinghausen. Eddinghausen dies. No try. The touch judge, Ross Pickard, has said that he's taken the corner post, and play will restart with a tap kick from the quarter line. The referee looked for the touch judge. Here it was, Linda back to Meninga. The basketball pass away to Ettinghausen. Ettinghausen for the corner. Ettinghausen dives, New Love's there, but the touch judge on that side of the field, in fact, he might have even lost it.
Yeah, I think he might have lost it over the line on the KFC replay, but good defence by New Love. Had to make up some extra ground, and it really is a let-off for Great Britain.
Well, the touch judge on that side of the field was the one who indicated to the referee that it wasn't a try. And who would have ever thought that Australia could have the ball for almost 18 tackles, 10 metres out and not score against anyone?
Against anyone, but, you know, you've got to give credit where credit's due, and Great Britain's defence was great. And Schofield's kick here is an absolute sensational one. You know, he knew his team was under pressure. Let's get the ball down the other end, and let's give Australia a make and get on their own 25.
Well, that might well be the turning point that really has put Australia right back on their heels. Steadman comes back into position, but that kick has taken play from the quarter line down Great Britain's end of the field to within 6 metres of the Australian line. And with Australia pressing and unable to score, what a way to rub salt into the wound. And now Daly loses the football on the first tackle. Steadman, a big smile on his face, says, come on, we've got these fellas. As the fire gets it in centre field. The quick pass. New Love. New Love still going. New Love within 12 metres of the line.
There's Sirrah, big Sirrah, they're flying off tackles. They're fired, trying to involve himself into the game.
And gets to within 5 metres of the line. Dermott, Edwards, Schofield, and now Betts. Only 5 metres away. Only a few seconds ago, it was Australia on the attack. They couldn't score. Schofield, the shot at field goal looks good. It is! A field goal to the skipper, Gary Schofield. And on the KFC scoreboard, Great Britain go further away. They lead Australia by 23 points to nil.
Well, that would deflate your confidence. 1 minute you're on their 25, next minute you're down your own 25. Your mate makes a mistake, he kicks a field goal, and now you've got to give them the ball back. Great little play there by Schofield. Really putting Australia under a heap of pressure.
Well, the thing was, it was Daly, an unexpected error. The amazing thing was that Australia had the balls for so long down that far end of the field, couldn't score. And Great Britain it was who turned it around with a magical kick, and then great defence to back up the kick. They're playing with a lot of spirit, a lot of determination. Great Britain on their own quarter line. Billy McGinty, gonna stop kicking. Got penalised in the first half for the kicking. That's Skerritt. Don't you feel sorry for a bloke like Andy Gregory?
Yeah, he goes home injured. And the next one aside pulls out a great display of Open Rugby League. And, you know, he's there sitting at home watching it on TV. But he'd be very proud of his boys.
Well, he'd be proud, all right. He'd just love to be out there. He was at the Stadium 88 when they won. He was at Wembley when they won. And now he's had to go home last weekend. As I said, he'd be very proud of this magnificent performance. And those two fellas, Newlove and Clark, almost unheralded, unknowns when they left Great Britain to come to Australia. Not unknown in Great Britain, but almost unknown here. They've been two of the heroes tonight. I think you've been impressed with Newlove in the centres.
Yeah, he's done a great job for him. You know, he's really kept Meninga under wraps. He really hasn't done anything at all. And that young Clark, he's a great player. And I'll tell you what, he's going to be in the Great Britain side for a long, long time to come.
Meninga gets it out wide. Here's Clyde. Clyde away to Ettinghausen. Ettinghausen chips ahead. This could be an Australian try. No, Steadman again saves the day. The advertising hoardings as Ettinghausen tried the chip and chase. Bobby Fulton, the Australian coach, looks a bit forlorn, but at least they're trying something. This is the second half. In the first half, they never looked like scoring a try. And Ettinghausen, a good pass. It was Clyde who sent him away. Here's the little chip. He was going to win the race for the football, or was he? Steadman just had that much margin on Ettinghausen. He's had a good game too, the fullback. Safely volleyballs it over the in goal line, the dead ball line, as the ball now is kicked off. Here's Daly, loping back. Sirenen. Kevin Walters. Kevin Walters in space. There's two Walters on it there at the moment. Kevin and his brother Steve at dummy half. Open side. Langer. Back it goes from Gillespie to Langer, and Langer just can't slip the pass away. It's his last disc defence that has saved the day so far for Great Britain tonight. The penalty goes against Great Britain for the professional foul. Langer decides to take the tip. Tap and Meninga knocks it on. Well, you wouldn't believe that, would you? Mal Meninga, tonight, he equals Reg Gasmere's record of 36 tests for Australia. And he makes a mistake like that on the KFC replay. Just didn't quite keep his eyes on the football. Maybe listening to what that Laurie Daly was saying on the outside, his Canberra teammate.
Problem is when you have probably too much ball that you have those little lapses. Great win here from the scrum from Walters.
Now Daly in the line, Australia. As Daly gets a good facial there. Now taking it up is Lindner. Lindner goes strongly, goes hard. He's only a metre short of the line. Steve Walters, dummy half. Langer. Langer the short pass to Harrigan, who's hammered in defence. Great Britain defence that time. Steve Walters will come the open side. Here's Langer. Langer decides to go on his own, but the Great Britain defence again equal to the task. Again, this is Daly. The ball comes away to Clyde. And again, Clyde, who on so many occasions would have scored then, is chopped down in some good defence. Steve Walters. Langer. Langer thinks about the little grubber kick. Now he puts it in. Getting back there is a fire. Now can he get back into the field of play? Meninga chases him. The fire's almost away. The fire is certainly back into the field of play. He almost ran around a lot of them.
Australia wouldn't. Langer put that little kick and he's trying his heart out tonight. They should have been there chasing their kick and they could have resulted in a try because there was no one else back there. He's played extremely well tonight, this Langer. He's tackled his heart out, trying to lift his team's performance all round.
Good tackle from Harrigan. Hasn't been enough of that from the Australians tonight, though. And what does the Australian selectors and the coach do for the next match? Will they stay with the same team? Be interesting to see what sort of changes they make, if they make any. Newlow, again making ground. And on the KFC scoreboard, as Glenn Lazarus warms up, it's still Great Britain in front by 23 points to nil. The kick from Steadman, taken well by Daly. Powell's there and so is Clark. 10 metres short of the halfway, we'll be asked to play the football. Kevin Walters finds a runner. This is Chris Johns. Off it goes. Kevin Walters again, his Broncos teammate.
Combining very well there, Walters and Johns. Looking for Eddinghausen on the outside, but it actually got inside for the pass. But Australia...
Sirenen going strongly. Sirenen to the quarter line. Sirenen can't get the pass away. Gee, that was a good tackle over the top from Dermot. Because there was a bit of support on this side of the field. Steve Walters from dummy half. Has he gone the wrong way? He may have. There was plenty of support on the left side. This time he goes that way. As it comes to Langer. Back on the inside comes Harrigan. Harrigan still going. Only 7 or 8 metres out. Langer again, first receiver. Langer thought about the kick. He'll score. No. Oh, how close can you go? Penalty against Great Britain for the swinging arm. How close could he have gone to score? Gee, when he stepped off the left foot, I thought that was shut the gate.
I thought he was going to go over. It was just that swinging arm by Dermot really sort of put him off balance.
So here's Australia again. Another sortie at the Great Britain line. Lindner still going strongly. Lindner dives. Can't get the ball down. Yes, he can. Referee says he scores. It wasn't a double movement. The referee perfectly positioned. Charged the line, on his back, leaned out with that long telescopic arm and scores Australia's first points with a try. Here it is on the replay, Lindner. taking two defenders with him, Edwards and also Dermott. At that stage, he wasn't held. At no stage did the ball touch the ground. The referee says this is a fair try.
Yeah, it's a great frame here by Bobby Linder. He's really got two players on Dermott and Edwards. He just reaches over the back door and puts the ball out. Just watch this magnificent play. Goes down hard and low. Gets turned on his back, managed to free the ball and put it over the try line.
Good try, good decision by referee Dennis Howe once again.
Bobby Linder, these days with Western Suburbs after starting in Brisbane, having stints with the Gold Coast and Parramatta. He's nearing 30. He's a big lump of a fellow, isn't he? He's in his 18th test, almost 17 stone of him. And Meninga taking over the kick with Wishart going off at half-time. He's got one from one Meninga. It's 23-6 the scoreline. On the KFC scoreboard, Great Britain 23, Australia 6. And Linder gets that much, I should say, Meninga gets that much closer to the all-time Anglo-Australian point-scoring record of 104 held by Graham Langlands. Linder now, I should say, Meninga now has 96. Linder the try-scorer. Can Australia get back from here?
Well, if they are going to get back from here, they've only got 24 minutes to do it in. And Great Britain doing the wise thing and slowing the game up, calling for the sandboy. They'll make a position to kick off, slow the game up as much as they can, kick the ball out, waste time, and they should come away with the victory. But like I said, still 24 minutes to go, Dave, and anything could happen.
17 points the margin. Steadman kicks off high. Daly. Now bringing it up is the replacement who's just come on, Glenn Lazarus, wearing headgear. Wearing headgear, you may remember, had to leave the field, knocked on by Australia. You may remember, Lazarus had to leave the field early in that first test match with a shocking head cut. And it's Sirenin who's gone off. So Sirenin, oh, Schofield knocks it on the first tackle. They were trying to work a move to this side of the field, eastward side of the field. Paul Sirenin has just made way for Glenn Lazarus. And Australia have made just far too many errors so far in this match to be competitive, making twice as many handling errors. And Great Britain leading 23 points to 6 on the KFC scoreboard. Australia have had to make three changes so far in the game. Peter Jackson's off. Wishart's off. Sirenin's off. And there it is. It's the big fellow Clyde, back to Kevin Wallace, and great defence. That was Sean Edwards. But Clyde it was again who made the initial bust. Steve Walters, Langer. Langer running freely. Runs across field, just outside the quarter line. Steve Walters. This is Lazarus. I suppose the question mark will come, when will Mal really make his replacements?
Well, I'd say that he went and look. He's warming up a couple of players now. He's a great little back here. Good defence by Great Britain once again. Well, they are tiring a little bit, and I'd say they'll put four players on straight away.
Here's Clyde. Clyde charging the line. Clyde can't get there. Last tackle against the Australian side. They're desperate to get back into this game. Langer, Kevin Walters. Out it comes to Chris Johns, and Chris Johns will score. Chris Johns is in. Try to Australia. Chris Johns scores. The combination with his Brisbane Broncos teammate Kevin Walters put him into the gap. Kevin Walters called for the ball. Langer, another from the Broncos, delivered the pass to Kevin Walters, and it was good timing. Here it is, Langer. And Kevin Walters comes across field. Johns runs straight through the gap. He's strong, he's hard, and he's quick. Good try, good combination.
Yeah, here we see the ball goes through Langer. Great pass out to Walters. Walters really just takes his time running to the line. Gives a great ball on the Johns. Runs through the gap, McDermott. And too much pace for Steadman coming across in cover defence. Good try by Australia. But it just shows how much time they've had with the ball, Australia, to come up with those points once again on the KFC replay. You see the short ball here, straight up to Johns. It just ran straight through the gap, and a good try. Really, that gets it right back in the game now.
Chrissy Johns would love that too. And Chris Johns, who's had a couple of clubs, he came to St George, he played quite well there, but since going to the Brisbane Broncos, he's had to suffer probably the hardest thing of all. He's the only New South Welshman who plays for the Broncos up until this year. And often he's had to play virtually against 13 or 14 of his teammates in State of Origin football.
Be a little bit lonely going into the dressing rooms afterwards.
Here's Meninga's kick. It's not a good one. Mal puts it straight across the face of the uprights. And so the KFC scoreboard, 20 minutes to go. Great Britain 23, Australia 10. Now, some of these replacements come on for Great Britain. Carl Harrison's out there. Paul Hume's out there. Let's see if we can work out who they've replaced. But big Carl Harrison and Paul Hume. A man who's not particularly popular with Australians or New Zealanders, Paul Hume. He's been known to put a bit of niggle in at times, but can play. And Carl Harrison, and there's two of the players that have come off, McGinty and Skerritt.
But McGinty's had a great game, and Skerritt really led from the front. Here goes Lazarus, having a big game since he's come on, making plenty of yardage for the Australians.
And there's Paul Hume, plays for Widnes, as does his brother. Carl Harrison, who only came out as a replacement a week and a half ago, played in all three test matches in 1990. Here's Harrigan going strongly. He's coming to his own in the second half, Harrigan.
Yeah, the Great Britain defence really not coming up in waves now. Not putting the Australians, and letting the Australians get the balls well, and it'll put them under a heap of pressure.
And this little man's making them pay at the moment. Langer. Langer looking for support. He finds it in Gillespie. It comes back towards Meninga. He can't handle the ball. After it seemed to have come up a Great Britain player anyway. I'm certain that Meninga only had to pick that ball up and he would have been in. On the KFC replay, the little man just stands them up again. He looks for support. Gillespie was there. Gillespie back on the inside, or did it touch Steadman? Very hard to tell. Anyway, the referee's going to put the scrum down with a Great Britain feed. I think in this second half is, Gary, the Great Britain haven't had much of the ball, and what they've had are a couple of times they've squandered.
Yeah, they have. They really have. But they put themselves under pressure. They should be now kicking out of trouble. There's no fullback. There has been a fullback back for three tackles, and they're still trying to ruck it up.
Great Britain bring it back towards the halfway. And as you can see, a much different statistic in this second test match. Great Britain missed far too many tackles in the first match. But tonight, tackling far better. And the scoreline on the KFC scoreboard, Great Britain 23, Australia 10, reflecting their far better and far more committed effort in defence. The kick straight down Daly's throat. In the first half, the kicks were being made to bounce, making both Eddinghausen and the wingers chase for it. Here's Hancock. He's a hard fella to bring down, isn't he?
So powerful. He's very, very strong around the legs, and he's going to make the Great Britain pay if they don't start putting him on the ground.
Harrison comes in and claims Lazarus, renewing the battle that they started a couple of years ago. But they both had a great battle at Old Trafford, and Lazarus turned Australia around after replacing Bella. Langer throws a couple of dummies, but Dermot, he wasn't in any chemist shop. He wasn't going to accept any of them. Clyde. Daly, the long pass, finds Meninga. Meninga, the little kick in behind the defence. Who's back there? In the end, Eddinghausen has a second bite at the cherry, and in trying to tow it ahead, kicks it over the touchline. There's the kick on the KFC replay. Gee, a fire was trying to get in the road of Meninga. That'd be like the Pony Express trying to get in front of a huge locomotive.
It sure would have been. I think Eddinghausen probably should have done the best thing there by just going down on the ball, because it would have been a restart for the Australians for another six tackles.
That's New Love coming off. Or is it? Look as if he was leaving the field.
Yeah, Gary Connolly's gone out in his position and gone to fullback, and Steadman will probably go into centre.
Well, it could even be Schofield in the centre and Steadman to 5'8", too. That could happen. Yeah. We'll wait and see how Great Britain line up. Although, of course, Schofield has wanted to be as much involved as possible, so you'd think that he'd certainly be trying to stay as close as he can to the action. Platt runs straight into the two props at the moment, Lazarus and Harrigan. A mistake from Harrison. Australia come up with the football. Gillespie plays it. Langer. Langer, away it comes to Clyde.
That's what Malcolm really wouldn't want, is mistakes his own half.
Especially from his fresh players. Harrigan gets down towards the quarter line. Lazarus. Lazarus running strongly. 20 metres out. Open side, Langer. Kevin Walters. Throws the dummy, goes on his own as Johns winners the decoy. Last tackle against Australia. Johns is the dummy half. Langer again. Langer decides to hoist it high. It's coming down almost in the same place. They all let it bounce. And in the end, Schofield says, thank you, I'll take that. Well, no one committed themselves to the ball on the full. Schofield hobbling to his feet. Sean Edwards probably came up and said, take your time, waste 30 seconds.
Yeah.
Just Mark the fire goes from dummy half. Certain Gary Freeman would have said the same.
Someone stapled on lines.
At this stage of the game, the competitiveness of fellows like you would certainly be thinking along those lines. You're in front. The clock's as good as anything at the moment for you. Yeah. When you're that far in front.
Well, that's what they're playing for. They're playing for time. They don't have to play for anything else. They don't have to do anything spectacular. They're just going to run forward and kick. And that's all they got to do.
Hume wrapped up. Good tackling from Australia. Gillespie and Clyde. Dermott. Steadman. Under a bit of pressure. Penalty against Harrison. Harrison stopping Lindner from coming through and applying the pressure. So Harrison's made two mistakes in the space of 60 seconds. On the KFC replay, you'll notice that right in the centre of the screen there, Harrison turned and deliberately blocked Lindner's progress. And so the penalty goes Australia's way. And again, not a great deal of difference in possession tonight. Great Britain have had a little bit more of the football, but they had a lot more of the football during the first half. Australia coming back in the second half. But have they left their run too late? 23 points to 10 is the score on the KFC scoreboard. Great Britain led 22-0 at half-time. Steve Walters. Steve Walters on his own. He hasn't done much running. Pops it over to brother Kevin Walters. Kevin Walters almost gets in behind the defence. Brad Mackay is now on the field for Australia. Langer. Aninga. Daly. On the bounce, Ettinghausen for the corner. Ettinghausen, a little kick in ahead. Can't regather it. Appeals to the touch judge that he was impeded after the kick. The touch judge says, no, the ball's gone touch in goal. On the KFC replay, there you are. Well, you couldn't really say a fire impeded him.
Well, there was no way he was going to get to the ball anyway, so he might as well have tried anything at that stage of it.
And the KFC scoreboard, it's Great Britain 23, Australia 10, and Meninga with a big shoulder charge. I told you, there's no love lost between the Australians and Paul Hughes. Whenever visiting teams go to witness, they seem to come away with the same opinion of him.
Yeah, it's not good, is it? But I just hope that big Kevin Iroh is watching that tackle and pulls off some of those tackles against Paul Hughes when we play him in a couple of weeks' time.
So Harrigan's come off the field, sitting next to Jackson. Mackay's gone on, which means that Clyde's gone into the second row. Mackay blocking the scrum. Johns on the runaround. Kevin Walters. Here's Hancock. Desperation defence from Great Britain. Penalty against the Great Britain side.
Those two wingers and Eastwood and Hancock, exactly the same style of player. Love getting up and trying to beat four or five players at a time. Very, very strong and very elusive.
Mackay taken a bit high by Harrison. And he's lost the ball. Scrum to go down. Brad Mackay wouldn't be happy with that.
Not on the first tackle, that's for sure.
Had two super games in the last two tests on the last tour when he was basically given the job of making sure that Hanley and Schofield ran back in amongst the forwards. Never let Hanley out of his sights. It was one of the major reasons. Played almost a breakaway's role in those last two tests. Did the job grandly. There he is affecting the tackle with Daly.
I think that tackle by Harrison sickened him a little bit. He was a little bit slow getting up and getting to that scrum before.
Harrison. Listen to that crowd start to sing.
It is great stuff. They are the best supporters in the world by far with their singing and the way they enjoy their football. Doesn't matter if it's soccer, rugby league or rugby.
Penalties going Australia's way now after early in the game. Great Britain had a run of them. Australia getting a slight advantage there. They kick wrong footing Daly momentarily. Back to the quarter line. It's a long time. Oh, he's lost the football on the first tackle. Well, it's a long time since we've seen Laurie Daly make two mistakes. Down this end of the football on the KFC replay. That was a great tackle. But twice we've seen Daly knock the ball on at this end of the field.
Yeah, Dennis Betts really drove his shoulder right into where the ball was situated there, come up with a great play, and that's put Australia back under pressure where they wouldn't want to be.
So here's Schofield running across field, gathered in by the Australian captain, Meninga.
Stedman. It's a great try. Watch his step off his right foot here. Gets around Clyde, gets around Meninga. Sizes up Enninghausen. And I'll tell you what, you've got to some pace to beat this bloke. And just re-left him for Dan Scores. A great try at the corner. Like you said, should wrap up this test match.
Here it is again. He made a horrible error in the opening moments of the Wembley Challenge Cup final this year. This will erase the memory of all of those. All Castleford supporters will forgive him for that, with that one try. That smile says it all on the KFC replay. And the man who made a fool of him at Wembley is the first one up there to give him a cuddle, Martin the Fire.
Yeah, well, that just shows you great team spirit there, that, you know, when he's out there playing against them, you know, it's them against them, and now when they're playing together, they go out there and congratulate each other. It's just team spirit. It's great harmony, and I tell you what, this sets it for a great showdown at Lang Park in that third vital test.
Mate, there are a group of Great Britain supporters. Look at that. Isn't that great to see?
Yeah, that's good.
Martin Afire says, thanks, mate. And Stedman says, yeah, I scored tonight.
Yeah.
There were a group of supporters who marched all the way out from the centre of Melbourne singing and playing drums. I think the march back to the city will be a lot longer and a lot louder.
Yeah, it'll be plenty loud. And I'll tell you what, they'll be having a great time, the English supporters. And I'll tell you what, the English players tonight can go back and relax. They know they've got a job to do next week. And Malcolm Willey's prepared his side extremely well, and they've come away with a great victory tonight, Dave.
As Powell goes off and Joe Lydon comes on. And Paul Eastwood, his most difficult kick of the evening.
And I'll back him in.
He's quite capable of it. We've got a good view of it. It looks good. Looks good. It's super. That's the test match for sure and certain. 29-10 on the KFC scoreboard. Australia have to score more than three times. They might have been able to do three tries in 10 minutes, but they can't score four. We're going to Lang Park next Friday night when the KFC battle for the Ashes goes right down to the wire. This Great Britain side was down and out. There was even bookmakers who suggested they were 15-1 tonight. They've burnt their fingers. They've come back like they did at the football stadium in 1988, like they did at Wembley in the first test match in 1990, and like they almost did at Old Trafford 2 years ago. But tonight, they've completely outplayed and outgone Australia. And they're going to go to Lang Park. It's not going to be easy for them up there. But it's certainly proved that they are more than a competitive football team. It's great Britain again, drive it back down towards Australia. Ettinghausen, he did well even to get himself into position to almost catch that on the full. Could really blame him when he knocked it backwards.
Yeah, well, he's probably, you know, run back 40 yards and put himself where the ball he thought was going to go. But I'll tell you what, those English supporters saying, here we go, I've got it all right tonight, that's for sure, because here we go, we're going to have a great, great test match at Lang Park. And I'll tell you, when these two sides meet again, what a game that's going to be.
Penalty against Great Britain. Betts looks at Schofield and says, was that you? Scully says, no.
Was it you? I don't think they'll mind who gave away that penalty at this stage of the game, Dave.
Not long to go in this match. As Lazarus brings it up, I think he'll get a start next Friday. There'll be a couple of changes at an Australian side. That's Langer. The flick pass back on the inside, beautifully read. Ettinghausen took it well, but Schofield read it just as well in defence. Langer again. The long ball. As Australia tried to take it up the centre through Mackay. On the halfway line, Steve Walters. Langer, he just hasn't been able to get into too much space tonight. They've really cut down his space. And perhaps Edwards' pace has had a bit to do with that. Anybody's ball from Steve, from Kevin Walters, finds brother Steve. Back it goes. Don't forget, this is the last tackle, and this could be another try to Great Britain. It's on the toe. Is Schofield going to win the race for the football? The ball's loose. He's going to win it. He's taken it too far in the end. In fact, it might have even been Eastwood. It was towed through originally, and it's Eastwood who went scurrying through after the football. And his second kick of the football, he couldn't quite control it well enough, and the ball beat them all over the dead ball line.
Yeah, he was a little bit unlucky there, but it's just the bounce of the ball, and I don't think they'll mind. The bounce will not go in their way at that stage of the game, Dave.
Well, Eastwood's had a great day, hasn't he? 6 from 6. For him, this is shades of Wembley. He scored a great try at Wembley. He had an unblemished kicking record in that victory 2 years ago. He's back into the Great Britain side after not being in the squad for the first test match. He's come out tonight and done the job magnificently. Meninga, knocked on by Daly. Great Britain have got the football. Well, what do Australia do, Gary? Is it just a matter of regrouping and rethinking? Or are there changes to be made?
Well, there could be a couple of changes made, but I think they've just got to really go into camp next week and just regroup and rethink how they approach this game. I think that they approached it a little bit relaxed. When they did come out on the park, I think they just really thought they were here to play a game and they'd be all right.
Now the little chip and chase is on again. The chip and chase away, it comes to Martin. The fire. A fire for the corner. A fire will win the race. Yes, he will. Try to Great Britain. Celebrating long and hard tonight. So will they. Here it comes, a little chip and chase. This fellow did it at Wembley a couple of years ago, Schofield, when he set up a try. That was a forward pass, though, I think. But on the KFC replay, no one's going to mind because they see the blistering pace of Chariots and pretty good pace from Ettinghausen too, I might add.
Yeah, it's a great little chip over here by Schofield. Really goes straight to O'Fire's wing. Well, there was a big forward pass, really, when you come look. Ettinghausen did his best to chase him, but the man's just got so much pace. See you later, shut the gate when he makes a little gap like that.
Here is again, Schofield. This man really is a good footballer. He's a very gifted player. And this man's got pace to burn, and so is the man that catches him, I might add. Look at this, he had to slow down fractionally. Ettinghausen, I thought, did very well, as well as the fire, to score the try. Eastwood looking for the football. He's not going to mind if time gets chewed up. We've waited almost the entire two test matches to see Martin Afire score a try.
We expected him to score a few in the series.
Well, he was unlucky in that first test, mate, really, that he should have virtually had two tries straight away in the first 10 minutes of the game, and it was only Eddie Howson's pace and electrifying tackling that really kept them out.
Well, you often wonder what might have been, as he really does salute the crowd, and Gary Schofield gives him a bit of a pat as well. What might have been had he been able to just not go into touch in those early moments. Very special good evening too to my, I've got a pub in town in Sydney. Manager comes from New Zealand, and his parents down at Cherry Island at Lake Taupo are watching tonight. So to the Hendersons and everyone else down there, beautiful part of the world. A good evening. I hope you're enjoying it as we approach midnight in New Zealand. And Rob sends his best. He'd be enjoying it too, because I know he backed Great Britain tonight. Here's Paul Eastwood from where he converted the Stedman try only moments ago. That one's not struck as well. And I don't think he's going to mind going away tonight with 6 from 7. And on the KFC scoreboard, it's now 3 points to 10. And it's all over. It's all over. Paul Eastwood raises his arms in exultation. 2 years ago, when they won at Wembley, Gary, I've never seen scenes like it. Steve Hansen doing handstands, people almost jumping into the crowd and getting kissed by supporters. Bobby Fulton might be forlorn, but at least he knows he's still got next Friday night at Lang Park, and those fellas are entitled to be happy. Dennis Betts and Billy McGinney and Dermot, the Wigan Six have set it up tonight. And good luck to the Wigan supporters and everyone from Great Britain. They can go home from Melbourne feeling happy, and Gary, it's Australia who have to go back to the drawing board, because tonight they were outplayed.
They were outplayed at
Great Britain. Phil Clark, Paul Newlove, Gary Schofield, Graham Stedman and Martin Afire scored tries. Eastwood 6 from 7 and Schofield a field goal. While for Australia, Bob Linder and Chris John scored tries. Meninga kicked 1 for 2. 33-10 the score. At halftime, it was 22 points to nil. We'll be back next Friday night from Lang Park in Brisbane when the KFC battle for the Ashes continues. It's going to be a great game. It's 1-1. Australia won at the stadium here in Melbourne. Like New Zealand last year, Australia have met their Waterloo. I hope you can join us next Friday night live from Lang Park.
TV3
AFC, let's take it now live to